Good morning, Professor Dr. Kunal Pal sir. I welcome you to this event. What to tell about Professor Dr. Kunal Pal sir? He's a dynamic. He's a dynamic personality with very energetic effort in research. Particularly, he has extended so many good publications, around 248 research publications, and having citations of 3,520, and also having one patent and one book, two book chapters. He has completed PhD from IIT Kharagpur and a master's from Jadavpur University, postdoc from Ryerson University, Toronto, Canada, and a research associate of IIT Delhi, member of Society of Biomaterials and Artificial Organizations, Pharmacy Ordinates Associations, and so many. Actually, sir has extended up to this a very young person and extended so many works. Novelty of works it matters a lot. Sir has devoted so many research papers and scientific works to the world. I welcome to this novel personality to share some few words with our participants. Over to Dr. Pal sir.
Thank you, madam, and thank you, principal sir. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to have a talk with you guys and share my experiences. So the topic of the seminar is on the plagiarism. So today I will be talking about that. Let me first share my screen. So can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Thanks for confirming. So yeah, thank you, Subhashree madam, for the nice introduction, and thank you for inviting me to give a lecture on plagiarism. This has become one of the important criteria in the life of not only the academicians but also the student researchers. I remember till say if we go back 5 years down the lane, this was not a big issue in India, but slowly since it is having a great impact across the globe, the Indian administration is also.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yeah.
Have you shared the slides?
Yeah, I have shared the slide.
Not visible, sir.
It's showing in my. You are sharing your entire screen.
Yes, it is visible, madam. I am seeing.
Subhashree, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay,
visible.
Okay. Yes. Okay, okay, sir. Actually, full screen of your peak is coming here. Okay, no problem. In as I am the host, sir, perhaps this is the problem. Sir, continue.
Sometimes when you have this. Bandwidth problem, then it happens.
So, as I was telling you,
since last 5 years back, if we go, so it was not a big issue. But however, currently it has becoming a a serious issue, and there are penalties which have been imposed by the government organizations, and also the UGC, they have recommended some guidelines. Okay, so till date, if you find the sensitization on the plagiarism in the Indian academics, it was not properly done, and this is one of the major reason. And today I'll be discussing about what is plagiarism, what constitutes the plagiarism, and all this thing, and how you can avoid plagiarism when you are writing your research papers and all these things, and I am editor and in of some of the edited books, and also I have been the guest editors guest editor in chief in some of the journals. So I will share my experience how as an editor of a book or a journal editor, what we look and what are the resources we are given by the funding agencies to check whether there is any plagiarism within a paper or not. Okay, so with this I will start my presentation. So as you know, if you see the word plagiarism, it has been derived from the Latin word plagiarius. Okay, and this plagiarius word, it literally means, if you go into the dictionary and find out, the plagiarius means the word, this means kidnapper. Okay, so you are kidnapping something. So what is kidnapping? Kidnapping is getting some object from someone or someone, basically, and claiming that thing to be yours. Okay, so that is regarded as the kidnapping on a broader scale. So in terms of this academics activities, including the term paper or what you write for your university and research paper and whatever report you submit to the university or the college for your grade work, so in that regard, the plagiarism has been defined as the representation of another author's language, thoughts, ideas or expressions as one's own original work. I would give a very simple example over here. If you go back to your school life, I believe many of you who were either very meritorious, or if you were not so meritorious, so what we used to do is that, suppose due to some reason I forgot to do my homework, so what I used to do, I used to take the copy of my best friend who would share his notes, and from there I used to copy down everything and I used to submit. Okay, now that work was not done by me. So basically that is another author's language, thoughts, ideas and expression. It is your friend's work, it is not your work. So we were submitting our copy as if we have done the homework. So that constitutes plagiarism. Okay, that also constitutes plagiarism, and we are not supposed to do that. But we are never told about this, we are not sensitized about this when we were kids. Okay, nowadays with the with the regulations tightening, the plagiarism is considered as a violation of the academic integrity, and it is correctly so. Okay, if you are found that you have violated the academic integrity, that means you have taken some author's language or thoughts or ideas or whatever, and you have represented it without giving proper citation. I am using a word, proper citation. If I say that I borrow your language, and then I say that this et al, they have reported this, then that will not be constituted or considered as the plagiarism, because I have properly cited. So many of us, we do not know how to properly cite and how we can do it, right? So that is one of the another problem. So if we are caught with the plagiarism, then we are subject to sanctions, such as we may be handed over some penalties, we may be suspended from our workplace, we may be expelled. If you are a student, you may be expelled from your school or college. Okay, even if you are working, you may lose your job, you may have to pay substantial fines, or if it is of very serious, it is of very serious nature, then you may also face incarceration. That means you may face jail. Okay. So suppose you are working with one news channel, and then you you move from that news channel and you go over there and to another news channel, and you use the news or whatever you have done in the previous organization also. Now that when you are working in the previous organization, and if you have collected some data or something, that is the property or the IPR of your previous organization. It is not the IPR or the work of your current organization. Okay. So if you publish some data from the previous organization and you do not give proper citation to that organization, then that organization may put a case against you that he or she has taken salary from us, he or she has taken fellowship from us, and after taking fellowship and all these things, while he has moved to the another organization, he has published those data which are the IPR of the institute. When you are working in an institute, you are getting salary. That means you are doing whatever the research you are doing as a paid worker of that institute. Okay. And as I said, you may be jailed. How you can be jailed? You can be punished in a court of law. Okay. So there might be other type of plagiarisms. Plagiarisms can be covered under this copyright infringement. Okay. There might be violation of the moral rights of contracts or torts. Okay. So in academia and industry, it is a serious ethical offense. It is a serious ethical offense. Okay. So if you see in most of my slides at the footnote, I have given some sources. Why? Because these are not my thoughts. If I use these words and if I do not disclose the source from where I have got the words, then I will be committing a plagiarism. So in my presentation also, see, from wherever I have taken the data, I have mentioned the source so that I am not held guilty of the plagiarism in my presentation. Okay. So we have never thought, if you see, since kids we have been giving presentation and we have been doing many a things, but we never give credit to the source because we are never sensitized to this issue. But now we have to be very careful whether you are writing your academic whatever the thing, academic thing you are doing, you have to be ultra careful that you disclose the source from where you have taken. It may exclude, say, some class notes or homeworks what your class teacher or the subject teacher may be given, because it is not going to, you are not publishing it somewhere and you are not taking credit of that one. That is just for the academic activity. But it is a healthy sign, or it would be a healthy practice, if you can start learning, because if you see, everything needs a practice. Okay, if you start practicing early, then when you go for your research activities, it will be better for you guys. Okay. Now, sensitization of the students and faculties, university should address the academic integrity by providing students with thorough orientations, required writing courses, and clearly articulated honor codes. Okay. So moving forward, what are the types of plagiarism? These types of plagiarism has been taken from this channel, My Research Support. This is a very good channel. If you are a researcher, if you are an M.Pharm students, PG student, or even if you are a UG student, or you are if you are even doing PhD, I would advise you to subscribe to this channel. And this guy, he is basically a professor, but I don't know from which university or who is running this channel. He is giving very good videos on how to write paper, so where to get your articles published, and there are many other research support what he is giving. And I have taken these things, these types of plagiarism from there, and you can go through the full video of his. Okay. So what are the different types of plagiarism? Complete or global plagiarism. Okay. Suppose, what is this complete or global plagiarism? Suppose a person A, he publishes a paper. Now I myself say I am B. What I do is that I download his paper. Okay, I download his paper. Then what I do? I create another document which is essentially the same as that of this document. And what I do is that I just change some words. Okay, I may change some words. Secondly, what I do, suppose he has given some bar graphs, I put it into, say he has made some bar graphs, and then I convert it into, say, scatter plot or some other plot. He has given some data in a table, I convert that table into a figure. Okay, so all of this, it falls under global plagiarism. Okay, it falls under global plagiarism. Okay, now the second thing is paraphrasing plagiarism. So in this plagiarism, what it is done is that I would use a different color pen over here. So I am B, I download this paper. Okay, and then what I do is that I rewrite this whole paper in my own language. Okay, I rewrite this whole paper in my own language and I publish it. But essentially all the contents of paper A are there in paper B. There is no deviation. Okay, you are not adding any new idea, new result, nothing. But I have rewritten all these things from the paper A and I publish it. So that comes under paraphrasing plagiarism. However, what is the important thing over here? If you see in the previous one, you have changed some graphs and all these things and you have changed some words. But essentially, all of the work or the writing was same. In this case, in paraphrasing, you are rewriting everything. So you will not, none of the software will be able to detect these wordings. Okay, so you will be initially, you will be able to pass through the screening of the editors and the reviewers. But at a later stage, if someone complains, then you will be in trouble. Okay. However, there is an exception over here. So I am talking about this thing, whatever I have talked about, it is about a research article. That means what you do is that you do some experiments and you write down this some topics or whatever the experiments you have done, whatever the results you have got, you note it down and you do it. So in these cases, this is valid. Now, in the case of review articles, what we do? In review articles, we basically take down the information from the information, sorry, from the different papers, right? And we concise it and write the article. So will it be coming under paraphrasing plagiarism? Definitely yes. Definitely yes. But if you give proper citation, giving proper citation in your review article will prevent you to be calling your article as the paraphrasing plagiarism. I hope you are able to understand. If anyone has any doubt, please don't hesitate to just inquire from me. Okay. So if you give proper citation, you will be able to prevent the plagiarism. Okay. This paraphrasing of plagiarism. Okay. Then verbatim, which is also regarded as copy paste plagiarism. Suppose in some of the cases, what I do is that I copy some of the lines from paper A, and in between I include those copy pasted lines. Okay. And I do not bother to change anything. Okay. So whatever the lines are there in A, I am just copying those lines and I am reproducing those copied lines in my own paper. So there will be some sections which will be totally copied from another paper. So that comes under this verbatim plagiarism. Okay. Then we have mosaic plagiarism, which is also regarded as patchwork plagiarism. Suppose I have written this line in my paper. Okay. Now this highlighted parts, these has been copied. Now this comes under patchwork. If you see, I have written the whole line starting from universities and it ends at honor codes, right? Now if you see, almost 30% of the line, it is not highlighted. However, the rest part of the line, it is highlighted. That means the rest part of the system I may have copied from another source. So that comes under patchwork, because in this full line I have not adapted the whole sentence from another thing. I have modulated the sentence. However, still there are some patches where we can get this patchwork plagiarism. Okay. So these four types of the plagiarisms, they are the most dangerous type of plagiarisms. And if you are caught with this one, then you will face penal provisions. Apart from that, we are having some self plagiarism. What happens? Suppose we have talked about paper A. The person A has written one paper. Suppose this first paper was written by you, and in the same paper you adapt some phrases from the first paper. So that is called self plagiarism. It is, the first one is also yours, the second one is also yours. If you look into the definition, it is called another author's language. So it is not saying, in the definition it is not saying that you cannot copy your work. So over here you get, over here in this domain where it is, where you are having self plagiarism, this means you are copying your own work. Okay. You are copying your own work, and that falls under the category of plagiarism. And lastly, accidental plagiarism. Suppose I have written this whole line. Okay. Now, while I am checking only say 2 to 3 words or 4 words, they are being caught, and none of the words are caught. So it was not your intention to do the copying, but what happens? Suppose you want to write, my name is Ram. So how many different ways you can write it that my name is Ram? Even you do not intend, there is no other words to express those wordings. Okay. So maybe one of the example, maybe say you have solution A while you are formulating any drug delivery systems. Suppose you are having solution B, you are having solution B. You have made two solutions separately. Now you are telling A is to be mixed with B. So how many different ways you can write this? So even if you try to change the words, they will be in between, say, mixing properly or homogenization properly, those words may be coming. So you are not intentionally doing it. So under that condition, we call it accidental plagiarism. These two plagiarisms, they are not of serious issue, but still we should take care of that. Again, over here in any of this plagiarism, if the wordings are not substantial and if you give proper citation, then you can save your back to a great extent. Okay. Giving citation to other people does not take away your own credit. Okay. So properly cite, always properly cite. Okay. Now considering this, on July 23rd, 2018, the UGC, it has brought some regulation. The name of the regulation is Promotion of Academic Integrity and Prevention of Plagiarism in Higher Educational Institutions Regulations. Okay. So what are the objectives of this guidelines? The objective is to create awareness among the people so that we can prevent plagiarism in Indian science. Okay. Then second is to constitute institutional mechanism through education and training. Okay. So that we can train our young researchers, our faculty colleagues, so that they can perform responsible research, study, project work, assignment, thesis, dissertation, promotion of academic integrity, and they can also help spread in the deterrence from the plagiarism. Okay. And thirdly, systems to detect plagiarism and to set up mechanisms to prevent plagiarism in the academic sections. And under this regulation, UGC has brought down that a faculty or a student can be punished. If you are a student, you may lose your academic degree. Okay. You may lose your academic degree. And if you are a faculty or a staff, you may lose your job. Okay. So they have brought these harsh punishments. So these lays out, this UGC guidelines lays out the different ways how an institute or a university can prevent the plagiarism. So they have assigned some duties to the higher educational institutes that includes colleges who are offering UG, PG, PhD degrees, universities. Okay. So first one is that awareness programs and training have to be conducted so as to sensitize the students and the faculties. And these trainings have to be conducted every semester. This has to be conducted every semester. So please get to this. Okay. So if you are an administrator, it is your responsibility that you conduct this kind of activity every semester. Otherwise you are violating the UGC regulation, which have been brought down on July 23rd, 2018. Then the higher educational institutes, they should instruct the students, faculties and the staffs after giving this proper training. They should instruct at regular intervals that proper attribution should be given to the work. If you are reusing something, seek permission for the reusing of the data from another paper, and the reuse permission has to be taken from the publisher. Okay, it has to be taken from the publisher. However, you may be interested in using some references from say some website or blogs. Okay, so if you are trying to get this thing, you have to get the permission of the person. Otherwise, at least give proper citation to them and acknowledgement of the source. Okay, acknowledgement of the source. So acknowledging someone's work, it does not bother you. Okay, and lastly, every educational institutes, they have to form two committees. One is Departmental Academic Integrity Committee, and the second one is Institutional Academic Integrity Committee. Okay, so these two committees will be responsible for redressing any issues related to plagiarism. Okay, now the contents of this slide has been taken from the Rashmi Chauhan channel. The YouTube link over here is given, so you can look over there, and she has make a wonderful video using the animations. Okay, so if you want to have a further knowledge, you can visit her channel. Now, second thing, next important thing is that compulsory research coursework on research ethics for the PG and the PhD students. It has to be floated and it has to be taken care of. So orientation and the refresher courses for the faculty members, it has to be conducted at regular interval. All the academic institutes has to give access to plagiarism detection software for all involved in research, both students and faculties. Okay, so what happens is that if you are not giving this software, you cannot take action on the person, Why? Because you have not given them a fair chance to detect whether their research work is having some plagiarism this thing or not. Because as I said, there might be an accidental plagiarism. Okay, there might be an self plagiarism. Okay, because so as I said, you want to write that I mix polymer A with polymer B and made this formulation and blah blah blah. So how many times you can a faculty can publish similar work? He may work on a similar domain. Okay, so they have to publish regularly. We also face this problem. Initially I used to tell my students, write in this way, write in that way, but nowadays I have stopped, because after some time, when I saw that when we are going for this thing, writing of future papers or further papers, what was happening is that my subconscious mind is having something kept in mind, and my subconscious mind tells me that that is the best language I can use. So every time, even though you are not looking into your previous papers, you will find many of the lines, they will be matching, right? So under those circumstances, it will be considered under self-plagiarism. Are you getting my point? So the institute has to provide access to the plagiarism detection software. Okay, now next, undertaking by the students have to be given, okay, during the submission of the thesis. Also certificate by the faculty needs to be attached that the thesis is not plagiarized. Okay, now how do you do this? Again, you have to have the access of the plagiarism detection software. Again, UGC has told under this guideline, submission of soft copy of the thesis and the dissertation to the InfliBNet database, it has to be done within a month of award of degree by the educational institutions. So basically, when you submit this database to this database, it uploads your thesis and everything to Shodganga, e-repository of Government of India. Okay. Further, in addition to this, UGC guideline mandates that every institution should have their own institutional repository, and all the work done by the student and the faculties should be uploaded in the institutional repository. Okay. However, if you are publishing something, you have to look into the hold up time. So every journal, and if you are contributing books, everywhere there is a time, there is a hold up time, and during that time you cannot upload the published papers in your institutional repository. So there is a hold up time. After that hold up time, in most of the cases it's 12 years, for some cases it is 24 months, not 12 years, sorry, 12 months, and many of the cases it is 24 months. So after 24 months you can upload it, upload the full author's copy, not the publisher's copy. You can upload the full author's copy to the institution repository. Okay. Further, UGC has given some excellent guidelines. Okay. While you will be detecting the plagiarism. Okay. So what it says, exclusion of all quoted work reproduced with necessary permissions and or attribution. Again, citation. If you give citation, if you have necessary permissions, you are safe. Okay. It is you. You have to give the proof that you have taken the permission. Okay. So exclusion of references, bibliography, table of content, preface and acknowledgements along with all generic terms. Okay. Laws, standard symbols and standard equations should be eliminated while you are detecting the level of the plagiarism. Okay. So what's included in plagiarism check? This is an important thing. Abstract, summary, hypothesis, observations, results, conclusions and recommendations. All of this, if you see, it is related to your work, what you are claiming in your thesis or in your paper, whatever you are claiming, these are all basically your ideas. It should be your ideas. If you are publishing a research article or if you are submitting your thesis or you are submitting your project report, all these sections will be checked for plagiarism. Okay. Also, the thesis should exclude common knowledge or the coincidental terms. And what is the limit? Up to 14 consecutive words, up to 14 consecutive works. Okay. Now, what does the UGC recommend if they find out that there has been some plagiarism? For students, there is a separate set of penalty, and for faculties, there is a separate sets of penalties. So the levels of plagiarisms, the plagiarism has been subsectioned into four levels: level 0, level 1, level 2, level 3. If there are similarity up to 10%, then there will be no penalty. Okay. So plagiarism, we'll be looking, again I am highlighting, we'll be looking over here. Abstract, summary, hypothesis, observation, results, conclusion and recommendations. Okay. In level 1, if it is above 10% and up to 40%, the students will be asked to revise his thesis within 6 months and resubmit. Revise and resubmit thesis. Okay, within 6 months. Okay. Level 2, 40% and up to 60%, revise thesis and resubmission only after a period of 1 year. So there is a cooling period of 1 year. In this case, you are not having, in the level one, you do not have any cooling period. If you revise your thesis, and you can submit it within 6 months. Again, the third level, above 60%, students' registration for the program will be terminated. Okay, this is a very serious thing. So a student, suppose you have, if you are a BTech student or BPharm student, you will be studying 4 years. And at the end of the 4 years, if you are found of level 3 plagiarism, your total degree will be cancelled. So you will be losing 4 years. If you are an MPharm student, you will be losing 2 years. And you have to re-register in the course and again go through the whole process. So please be careful. And if you are a PhD student, 5 to 6 years of work will be gone. Okay. Even if 1 year of 1 year loss is a very big loss. Okay. So levels of plagiarism for faculties, levels are same. Level zero, no penalty. Level one, 10 and up to 40%, withdrawing of the publication. Okay, publication will be withdrawn. 40% up to 60%, withdrawal of the manuscript, and denial of one annual increment, and cannot supervise students for 2 years. Level three, punishment, withdrawal of the manuscript, denial of two increments, and cannot supervise for 2 years. Okay, and if it is a repeated offense, suspension or termination of the service. Suspension or termination of the service. Now there is an interesting thing. I don't know whether you have noticed or not, but none of you asked me. I hope that you will be asking me. So what about the paraphrasing? So UGC guideline is silent over here, right? So this is an interesting thing, because as I told you when I was talking about this paraphrasing, it is not possible. If you rewrite the whole thing in your own words, it becomes very difficult to catch hold of the paraphrased plagiarism. Okay, but since there is no rule, there is a loophole, so you may get off. But if the publisher can catches you, then you will be in trouble. Okay, so please be careful while you are paraphrasing. Give proper citation and you will be safe. Okay, how to avoid plagiarism? This is an important thing. So again, this has been taken by this my research support this thing. Please visit his site, this YouTube channel, and you can look into his full lecture. Is there anyone who is asking something? Who wants to ask something? No? Okay. So, how to avoid plagiarism? Someone's microphone is on. Can you please put it off? It is giving an awkward noise.
Gayatri Jess. Gayatri Jess, please switch up your mic. Gayatri Jess. Gayatri Jess, please switch up your mic.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Not now. Still now he is not done. Gayatri Jess. Okay, sir. Okay. Now it is okay.
Yeah. So how to avoid plagiarism? To avoid plagiarism, we need to understand what is plagiarism. Okay?
Sir, I have one question, sir. I am Subhakant Das from Synergy Institute of Engineering Technology, Dhenkanar.
Yeah.
My question is, suppose I have written a paper and I have done it's a Turnitin report. Sometimes it is seen that my name, my institute name is Turnitin's software is captured, and it is showing the percentage of plagiarism. So how can you avoid this, sir?
That's what I said, na. If you look into here, abstract, summary, hypothesis, observation, yeah. Okay, so when you are going for this uploading, when you are, if you are trying to avoid that, while you are uploading your file in the Turnitin software, what you do is that you remove your name, your affiliation. You don't need. You just need to analyze these things, even in your paper.
Okay.
Right. So okay. You just upload the title of your paper, and then followed by your abstract, introduction. If you are having materials and methods, in materials and methods also you will be finding there will be a lot of plagiarism which will be caught, similarity. Why? Suppose you have got one chemical, say for example you have got hydrochloric acid from high media, so you cannot change that. Can you? It's not possible, right? So journals, they also take that into account, that those are not possible, and they exclude those things. Okay.
Okay.
So next thing is that if you are a student, start early to prepare your reports, papers and thesis. Okay. Then next is paraphrase properly. Paraphrase properly. And with that, citation of the literature. Combine these two. Okay. Paraphrase properly and give citation from where you have paraphrased. So this will save you. Okay. And concentrate when you are writing your results and this thing, concentrate on presenting your own ideas. Okay. You present your own ideas, but in some cases, in many of the cases, when we write the paper, we write results and discussions. In short, I am writing R&D. Okay. It is not research and development. It is results and discussions. Okay. So in this results and discussion, suppose you have written a wonderful experiment that when I mixed say a polymer with when I mix a say carbon nanotube CNT with a polymer, it gives me a black hue. Now you have to support that observation with some previous literature. So then what you do, that you write similar observations have been reported by this and this et al. In this paper where they have mixed this and this. Okay. Where, maybe where they have mixed CNT with another polymer, and they have shown that this kind of black hue is there. So in that also, you have to write the whatever the observation of the other paper in maybe in one or two lines, and then give a proper citation. Okay. So you do not copy the whole sentence from that paper. You read the whole paper and write in your own words. So that is what you are having, presenting your own ideas. So you are taking a cue from there. That is not your original work. Your original work is that you have mixed CNT with polymer A and you have casted a film and you have got a film. Right? Now this film is showing some property. So this is your idea. But why it is black? If you have to justify, you have to draw the reference from other thing, and that is not your idea. Okay, and why it is giving a black color, and if you have to explain it, you have to give the reference over there, because the another author, he has discovered why addition of CNT is giving a black color film. Okay. Now software for plagiarism checking. So there are three softwares: Turnitin. Many of the academic institutes, they use. There is Urkund, what Government of India, they provide it to many of the organizations. That is also there. But I find it a bit difficult to work with. So we, our institute, NIT Rourkela, they provide us with Turnitin software. and I will show you how to work on that and what to expect over there. Then we have Authenticate. So then the interface of Turnitin, I will show both of them. Interface of Turnitin and Authenticate, both are similar, but the price of Authenticate is bit higher, quite high. Okay. Then there is another software, Plagiarism Detector. This this will help you in getting your stuffs checked pretty easily. Okay. So let me go to the this software. So in this software, I am in this Turnitin. So this has been given by our institute. So see, we have done something. Now what happens is that over here it is saying 21%. Let me click on this and let me go to the report. See, whatever the problem you are saying, our affiliations, they are getting highlighted, they are being caught over there. Okay. Now if you see, as per the UGC rule, how many consecutive word? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Over here I am having 6. UGC says we can have 14 words, 14 consecutive words which may be copied. Okay. So all of this, if you see over here, these are not that we have tried to intentionally do it. So these are accidental plagiarism. Okay. Edible films and coatings, this is a very common term. So even if you have not intended to do that, it will come. Over here, see, improved the functional properties of the edible films. Now see, this is a patchwork. In this line, there is a whole line. Now what we are getting at the 4, this improvement of the functional properties and films. So this is patchwork plagiarism or mosaic plagiarism. Okay. So you will find that before we submit any paper, we all go for this thing. Now see, as categorized as generally recognized as saved by food and this is not my word. I am not stealing any words, this thing. So essential oils, they are basically they are grass materials and they have been approved by the Food and Drug Administration of United States. Right. Now again, we have given the references in between. So in this way, this is how you look over here. And then if you come down at the bottom of this paper, oh, sorry, not here, here I suppose. So it gives you from which paper you have copied. So you see there is 1, 2. So one was at the top. So it says, you see this one, it has been copied from this thing, but it is not my this thing, it is the journal's feedback. So it is not my intentional this thing, right? So in this way you can find out from where it is catching these references, and then what you do is that you can download it. I am not downloading it because it takes a lot of time. So what we do over here is that after downloading, suppose I get to the region where it is highlighting, and it's better that you give a reference over there. See, we have taken this image from 93 in the reference number, okay, and we have given that we have reproduced it with permission, so it now does not come under plagiarism. Okay, now same thing if you come over here, this is an authenticated software, sorry, this is the authenticated software. Now if you see, we are getting this thing. So this 21%, if you see 8%, 18%, they are under acceptable limit. It is giving you, even with the Turnitin, if you see, if you are having some grave concern, minimally grave concern, then you will be having this yellow colored marking. Okay, otherwise if you are safe, if the software thinks that you have not done any plagiarism, it will give you a green sheet. Okay, similarly over here in the authenticate also, you will be getting the report, and if it is within the acceptable limit, it gives say 8% gray color, and if it is 20 or 21%, then there is a consideration that we need to check carefully, and we need to check whether if we remove these equations from the because standard equations you cannot change. Okay, so after, even after removing these standard equations and all these things, you are not having you are having the plagiarism within the safe limit. So it is your duty. However, working with these two softwares is very costly. Okay, we are able to work because Turnitin, my institute is providing us as an academician. They have given us access. Okay, because this is as per the guidelines of the Ministry of Education. Okay, so we go by the Government of India rules, right? Authenticate, publisher wants me to check that there is no serious concern. Today only I have written one or two papers from one of the chapters to one of the authors, saying that the limit is quite high, so you please do it, you please check it, and you then resubmit it. Okay, so we are bound by this laws. So anything you give or take 20%, you have to bring it down. You have to bring it down. Okay, but these are quite costly. Now suppose you are my friend, you are my very close friend, I am having access to Turnitin. Okay, and you ask me, Kunal sir, isko thoda kar do. I can do it for you once or twice, and if you give me pain for every 2 to 3 days, after some time, say after 5 or 10 times, I will say no bhaiya, I will not be able to do it for you. Okay, there is a cheap solution. I am not advertising, I am not being paid by anyone to advertise this thing. I personally have this software, I have used this, that's why I am telling you that you may consider it. So what happens over there is that this plagiarism hyphen detector, they have this software, and if you get 2PC license, it is lifetime free for 3600, so per PC 1800. You will not get a very good functionality like Turnitin and this thing, but at least if anyone copies or anything matches with the open sources, this software is very good. And I will show you, I don't know here, yeah, let me check, yeah. Plagiarism detector, yeah. So I personally use it, and it's lifetime fee. Once you procure it, it's lifetime fee. Okay, so show reports. So see, in this one there is a 24% plagiarism, so I can save the report as a PDF file, so you can do it whatever you like. Okay, now I will move forward. Next is referencing software. In referencing software, there are 3 softwares. EndNote, it is a paid software. but you have Mendeley and Zotero. We have given how to use Mendeley and Zotero for the referencing, because I have told you how important it is to give citations. So EndNote, it gives you to use EndNote web for free, and it can support up to 50 references at a time. Okay, so we have our lab, we have a YouTube channel, and if you go over there, it's called MEI Lab. Okay, if you go over here and go for this playlist, you will find this thing, bibliometric analysis, book chapter resources. Yeah, tutorial for free reference online, this thing. So our channel name is MEI Lab, NIT Rourkela. So over here we have given this how to use Zotero. It is a free referencing software. EndNote Web, it is a free referencing manager. Okay, Mendeley, it is again a free this thing. So you can look into this and you can use it freely. Okay, EndNote, it is having a limited this thing, limited resources. It will give you limited resources. However, if you are not having money, you can go for Mendeley and or Zotero, whatever you like. But use this referencing software. It will make your life quite easy. Okay, and yeah, lastly, it is not related to this plagiarism, but I would advise you to go for the Grammarly software. Why it is important is that we are not native English speaking writers. Okay, so we are bound to do mistakes. Even after so much 12 years of experience, I do mistakes here and there. Okay, Grammarly, the free version, I am not telling you, you go for the paid version. Grammarly, go for the free version, and the free version will give you the basic this thing. Suppose over here, my student has written for the delivery of the varied range of thing. What it says, do not write the varied, a varied. Okay, so Grammarly is software, it is one of the best softwares, and it can help you in improving the quality of your paper like anything, believe me. And we have been using it quite often. Okay, all my students, they use it. So it is a free software, why not to use? Okay, so with this I conclude my lecture, and thank you for all for your patient hearing and listening out to me. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'll be quite obliged to answer those queries.
Those who are interested, please ask question. Participants. Any questions?
No? Okay then.
Sir, one question, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, how can you, you mentioned that the reference you can use EndNote, Mendeley, and Zotero. Can you, sir, give me one demo, sir? How can you know by using this we can be use the reference?
Okay. That's not a good deal. So I basically, because EndNote is not that costly, 10,000 rupees for for three licenses. So if I were you, I would have just joined hands with a few of my colleagues, two more colleagues, and I would have got an end-note license. Okay, so it's not much. It's only 10,000 rupees. Okay, so what you do is that there are many ways. I will show you two ways. First, Science Direct, you go. Suppose I search for bone tissue engineering. Go over here. Now see, over here, there is a site. You can add to Mendeley also, but I do not use because I prefer EndNote. It is quite easier. Free software, they have some issues also. So I use this thing. So you go to export to citations. Okay. Suppose it is there. Then I will tell you a thing. I go to the EndNote. Say I go to numbered version. It will be easier for you to visualize. See, there is one and here there is two. Suppose I want to insert a reference over here. Okay. Over here, I have selected this reference. I want to insert it. I go over here, EndNote tab, insert citation, insert selected citation. Now you please look into this one and two, what is happening, especially the two. See, here it has become two, here it has become three. Now reference style is numbered. Reference style is numbered, right? Now, if I say change it to APA style, there are many other styles we use these things. So I go to APA 6. So it automatically changes everything. So it takes care of the references for me automatically. Okay. So this is the first thing. See, APA 6, it has changed. Now suppose I want to send it to another journal where, say, food chemistry journal. When I click to food chemistry journal, it will change the references according to the food chemistry journal. Okay. So there is another way. Same. Many of us, we use Scholar. Okay. So if I search something, say silica bone tissue engineering, see, it's coming over here. There is nothing over here, right? So what I will do, I will go to here. I will go to settings. And after go to settings, I will show, click on this, show links to import citations into EndNote. Okay. I would save it. I would go over here. Again, I will search. See, import to EndNote. I want to include this reference. Open. It gets into this, what you call EndNote. I come over here. I want to put let me change it to numbered so that it will be easier for you to visualize. So it is numbered. Now you just put this thing. I want to insert that citation. See, See, 3 has come over here automatically, and 4 is here. Are you getting my point? So these are the two ways. So I showed you in Science Direct that you can go for how to get the this citation. Okay, every whatever the paper homepage you will open, you will
get. Sir.
Yes, yes.
Anil sir, sorry for the interruption. Prabhas sir has joined. So first I have good morning, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir. How are you doing, Sahu sir?
Oh, good morning. Very fine. Thank you.
Yeah, good, good.
wish happy new year to you and all the.
Yes. Okay, madam. Then I will conclude.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Sir, no, sir. Only I have to.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. If anyone is having, I am done basically, sir. If anyone is having any question, short question maybe. No. Okay then, madam, I am done. Thank you for very much for your patient hearing, everyone. Thank you, principal sir, for inviting me.
Thank you,
Subhashri madam. Thank you, Professor Sahu, for recommending me for this what do you call one day national seminar. Thanks for believing in me.
Thank you, sir. Sir, 1 minute, sir. Sir, please don't leave. Kunal sir.
Yeah, sure.
Yes, sir. Now I request our patron of the event, Vice Chairman, Kanak Manjari Institute of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Raukla, Dr. Sri Patnaik, to give cheer up to Dr. Pal sir. Over to Sri Patnaik, madam.
Thank you so much, Subhashri ma'am. So on behalf of the entire KMIS fraternity, sir, I would definitely like to thank you, Kunal sir, for being the chief speaker and raising the most valuable moment at Kanak Manjari International, Kanak Manjari Institute of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Raukla. Sir, thank you so much and for encouraging this national seminar. And I'm sure that our participants must have noted their suggestion and will be discussing within their organization the various aspects of plagiarism. And sir, thank you again for sharing such an interesting and stimulating address and discussing various aspects. And on behalf again of the entire Kanak Manjari Institute of Pharmaceutical Sciences fraternity, please accept this as a token of our appreciation.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for your kind words. It was my pleasure to give a talk. So I love teaching. So anytime.
Thank you so much, okay. Sir. We are really privileged to have you here.
Yes. Thank you, madam.
Thank you so much. Yeah.